Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise. Philippians 4:6-7. It says, be anxious In everything, with prayer and thanksgiving, with supplication, with gratitude, make your request known to God. The peace of praise God. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will protect your hearts and mind to Christ Jesus. After that, I begin to feel okay. The anxiety begins to fizzle away. And I was supposed to go to London yesterday. And I said, no, let me pray, God. If you want me to go, let me go. If you don't want me to go, let me stay. So instead of going, I went to the storage. I stayed there, put a few things together. And then the spirit said, go and see one of your customers right here. I went to see him and he said, this week you can come and supply me some of your lights. Mm-hmm. Well, God, you are amazing.
Yes.
And it's good to listen to the spirit.
Yes.
When we are anxious, the verse that came to me was Philippians 4:6. So let us all be encouraged. It's not easy sometimes, but our God is not dead. He's alive.
Amen.
Be blessed.
Amen. In the middle or in the midst of every problem, God has provided a solution. And I pray our eyes will be opened to see the solution in the midst of the problem we're going through. The scripture says when Jesus went to the lake of Gennesaret, the multitude pressed on him. And as they pressed on him, he was probably wondering, how am I going to preach to these people who are pressing on me by the sea? And the scripture says he lifted up his eyes and he saw two boats. What I saw in that scripture is that in every problem, if we are sensitive to the Spirit of God, our eyes will be open to see the solution. So, amen.
Amen.
We've got a minstrel in the house. Welcome, Sister KK.
This is my way, my desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my way, my hunger and need, my God is the God who provides. This is
15 says, "For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest we shall be saved, and in quietness and confidence shall be your strength. For that you will not know, but you will.
No.
You will.
Amen.
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 I was talking to just put that with no, but you will.
Amen.
Because our brother did the same thing. See, the people that get blessing from God in the time of their trouble, know what they do? They find rest. They return to God and find rest. So in returning and rest, you shall be saved. When you say saved, doesn't mean you shall be born again. Mean you shall be saved from trouble. The one that is making you to cry.
That's why I encourage you to cry. You give them Molakeni. You are giving him Anki. Did anybody give me Anki when I cry? That's what the Lord asked me. He said, they are giving him Anki. And when you cry here, they're just looking at you. I'm just joking. That's it. Let everybody cry. When you cry, your tears are precious before God. It shows how empty you are. And how refilling you want God to refill you. In returning and rest, you shall be saved. When we are in God's presence, forget about civilization. Forget about being civil. Being gentlemanly. If crying is going to make you better, why don't you cry? Everyone has ever cried, after they have cried, not until they cry, you are not comforted. When you cry, it makes you comforted, especially if you are crying to God. In returning and rest, you shall be saved. So if you want to be saved, return to God before resting. He said, in addition, in quietness and confidence shall be your strength. You're looking for strength. Strength is not where there are a lot of crowd or people making noise. Strength is not where people fall down. They said they fall down under their net and they're making, pushing the chairs. Even demons also demonstrate there. The place of quietness is a place of confidence and is a place of strength. That's why you must have quiet time. Along with God. But you will not. But you will.
Amen.
And so, Father, we thank you.
Thank you.
The entrance of your word give light and understanding to the sinner. Speak to us, O God. We are waiting. We need you. We want you. Send forth your word. So quietness and confidence shall be our strength. Returning and rest, before 2015, shall we be saved. But you will not. But we pray that this, we will. You will enable us. So always find that place of strength. That place of safety. Take us out of that busy life that deny us from the place of strength and rest. Let us be wise enough to always carve out the time alone with you. Mark 1:35, Jesus Christ woke up early in the morning alone with God. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
James chapter 4, verse 3. James chapter 4, verse 3. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Today we are going to learn another key or other keys that we discussed last week to getting results in our daily prayers with God. Last week, we learned that one, you will be abusing God if you only come to Him when you have a need. That's what we call God abuse. Because you're only using God to get by and by. What is the point in praying always if all prayers are answered immediately? So some prayers will not be answered immediately. And that's why Jesus said in Luke chapter 18 verse 1, men always ought to pray and not lose out. So it is God abuse if you only come when you have a need. God wants a fellowship, a communion with Him. Not only when you have a need, even when you don't have a need. That's why at times you allow some things to get bad before He steps in. Because if he steps in before they get bad, you think he did it on your own. Number two, we also learned, as a result of the need to fellowship with God, communion with God, that God does not always answer that prayer immediately because he wants you to fellowship with him. He doesn't want a Sunday fellowship. He wants every day. In your room, in the toilet, in your car, in the living room, just practice the presence of God. God is there. Talk to me. When you acknowledge him, Peter acknowledged God in the house of Cornelius, chapter 10. He said in that verse, from verse 33, I believe, he said, now I know, I perceive that God is not respecter of anyone. God is not partial. Say, out of every nation, he that fear God and do what is right is accepted by him. How do you know you are anointed? When you fear God and do what is right. So in that James chapter 4 verse 3, the New International Bible said, when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. Motives are reasons. There are good reasons and there are wrong reasons. People that ask with wrong reasons, they don't receive. Asking for the wrong reasons, that is for your own pleasure. Nothing to do with God, nothing to do with service to God or service to human being. It's wrong. They are wrong motives. So today's title is Praying Amiss. What do I say?
Praying Amiss.
Praying Amiss is praying off target. Praying Amiss is groping. It's like groping prayer without bother to get answers. Some pray because other people are praying. Some pray because, let me just pray. Number three, it says some ask and they do not receive. That means that not all prayers are answered. It's not enough to say not all prayers are answered immediately. But in addition to it, not all prayers are even answered. And why? Because they ask for the wrong reasons, isn't it? Amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 18, verses 7 to 8. And shall God not avenge his own elect, Jesus would, who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? Doesn't that tell you that God is a patient God? God of patience? Doesn't that tell you that God bears long so that even prayer that have not yet produced results is a test of your own endurance? And that is why we cry. Because we want the answer. But God says, I have gone ahead to prepare a place for you. Can you wait? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? When Christ returns, will he still find people coming to the church? When Christ returns, will he still find people believing God? That's what he said. When Christ returns, will he still find people praying that my prayer will be answered? Number four, from verse 7 of this one, we understand, as we did last week, that prayer must be what? Regular. Say, shall God not avenge for his elect that cry to him how day and night? So prayer must be regular. Day and night. Night and day. So must we pray. Not only on Sundays. So it bears long with them. Prayer that brings results is a test of endurance. And we also said that not all prayers are answered immediately. The parable of the persistent widow is an example of this. When we are talking like this, when I'm talking like this, I'm just expressing my own understanding and my lifestyle of the prayer. If what I'm teaching you is not what I do, I will not be passionate about it. And I want you to do the same thing. Don't just come to church. Be a practitioner of the messages you are hearing. Because a time will come whereby God Himself will separate the those that are doing it from those that are not doing it. You see, the brother prayed, and then God gave him an answer. And he said, go and supply the lanterns. That was a miracle. Because he put a demand on God. And God responded. Will you find God at home when it's your time? That's why I'm helping us to build a strong relationship with God. It's not sufficient to say, I come to church. No. It's about what you do outside the church. You must study the Bible on your own. You can study it. All the things you are hearing, go back home and study them. That is what changes our lives. And that is what makes God to be present with you in your own day of trouble. Verse 8. I tell you that he will avenge them how? Speedily. Prayers for justice will be avenged speedily. If anybody wants to cheat you, if anybody wants to do things that are not good to you, if anybody wants to step on you, if anybody wants to do any wicked thing against you, God will avenge for you. How? Speedily. That's what Jesus Christ said. So the widow's prayer for justice was finally avenged. But not speedily. Do you know it wasn't speedily? Because that was why she kept coming. That was why she was persistent. But Jesus said, I tell you, God will avenge for his own elect that cry out to him day and night, how? Speedily. Somebody will not be able to sleep. Why? Because they refuse to pay you your money. Somebody will begin to see spirit running after them in their dream, nightmares. Why? Because they said they are not going to pay you your money. To survive a man in his way, Lamentation 3, God does not approve. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the prayer for justice by righteous people, God said he would avenge for them. How? Speedily. So long you leave it to God, you are not taking justice into your own hand. Because the Lord says, vengeance is mine. Isn't it? Psalm 94, verse 1. O Lord God, to whom vengeance belongs, O God, to whom vengeance belongs, shine forth. The King James Bible says, shew forth. That is, show yourself. The prayer of vengeance, the prayer for justice, rather, by the righteous man will be avenged speedily. The parable of the persistent widow demonstrate to us how the woman prayed to the judge to avenge her. Number two, what happened? How do you pray amiss? To pray amiss is to be praying to God for justice while at the same time you are taking justice into your own hand. So we're saying that number one, praying amiss is not only when you pray with wrong motives. You're not saying number two, how people people pray amiss is when, on the one hand, they are praying to God for justice, and on the other hand, they are actually taking justice into their own hands. Was that what the widow did?
No.
The widow did not take justice into her own hands. Rather, she submitted the justice to the judge. The widow prayed for justice, and the judge answered her. Why pray for justice if she could do it herself? So if you want God to avenge for you, please don't avenge yourself. People can pray amiss if they are competing for justice with God. Oh God, to whom justice belongs. Oh God, to whom vengeance belongs. Show yourself. How can God show himself if you struggle with him? Let go. Let God. Except the Lord builds the house, the labor in vain that builds, that built. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. Psalm 127 verse 1. It is vain labor if you don't let go and let God. It is vain. When the nation of Israel left Egypt for the promised land, they faced an hurdle, the Red Sea. Exodus chapter 14, verse 10. When Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. Egyptian marching after them, wherever you see the word Egyptian, it talks about injustice. You see? The Egyptians marched after them. So they were afraid, and they cried out to the Lord. Verses 13 to 14, please. And Moses said to the people, their leader, he said, do not be afraid. So when problem comes, the natural thing is to be afraid. But then, you are not natural. You are spiritual. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That makes you supernatural. We are living in the world, but we are not of the world. Jesus said, I will never leave you alone. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Is it that the word of God is true or is not true? Is it true?
Yeah.
If the word of God is true, let's take God at his word. Yeah. So when trouble comes, do not be afraid. Say, Moses said, do not be afraid, stand still and see. In returning and rest, shall you be saved. Hello?
Yes.
In returning and
rest,
shall you be saved.
Amen.
Moses said, stand still. If you are not returning to God to find rest, can you stand still? So stand still and see. Unless you stood still, you cannot see. Because what the devil wants to do for you is to ruffle you, embitter you, confuse you, and worry. Because when all this comes all at once, he wanted to throw it down. But many are the afflictions of the righteous. But God delivered them out of it all. Amen.
Amen.
Stand and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish tomorrow.
Today,
the same day you are finding the trouble. Amen. So if you don't want your own salvation to be postponed, if you don't want your own blessing to be next week, if you want it now, today, what will you do? Stand
still.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So the devil has been defeated. Why? Because what he wants wants you to do is to do opposite to what God says you do. He doesn't want you to stand still. Because he knew that if he can trouble you so you are not standing still, you will not see.
Yeah.
But I want to see.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
That woman said, come and see.
Yes.
The woman of Samaria, come and see. So if you want to see, stand still and see. Today. Today, not tomorrow.
Yeah.
In Africa, they sing that song. Today, today. Today, today, not tomorrow, Jesus will visit me, today, today.
Hallelujah.
Okay, we are in England. For the Egyptians whom you see today, if you don't send them away, they will come tomorrow. So send them away today. The Egyptian you see today, you shall see them
no,
forever.
Hallelujah.
That's if you do it today. Am I talking to somebody?
Yes.
I know. Brother said it's not easy. Yes, tell me. We said his grace is sufficient.
Amen.
One will just lead his direction. If we return, we find rest. And we find rest, we will find salvation. Said the Lord will fight for you. Not for them. The Lord will fight for you. When? Today. And you shall hold your peace. So it is vain labor praying that God fight for you while at the same time fighting for yourself. Praying amiss. Luke chapter 5, verses 4 to 6, very quickly. When he has stopped speaking, who? Jesus. He said to Simon, launch out into the deep. That is, cast your net for a catch. Launch out into the deep, that is, sea, and let down. Cast your net for a catch. Verse 5. But Simon answered, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. That sounds familiar. I've worked so hard, but nothing to show for all my labor. God is turning things around for you. But not before his attitude changed. Though I have justification, I'm washing my net because I've toiled all night, isn't it? And you're telling me to cast, launch out into the deep. I'm a fisherman, professional one. I've done this. Then, Jesus did not say anything. But the man answered, okay, nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. Thank God he did.
Yeah.
Verse 6. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their nets was broken.
Yeah.
Obedience is better than sacrifice. Thank God he did. Number 3, the third way you might have been praying amiss is not obeying the word of God. Because God knows if you obey him or you don't obey him. And the God you don't obey his word in the day of plenty, how do you want him to help you in the day of your empty? Peter said, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. If you don't want to pray amiss, don't disobey the word of God. The man obeyed, said, nevertheless, at your word, because you have said so, I'm going to give the word of God a chance. I'm going to do it. Anyway, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12a says, the word of God is quick and powerful. Psalm 119, verse 11 says, thy word I hid in my heart that I do not sin against thee. The word of God is very powerful. You cannot be breaking the law and expect the law to protect you. Isaiah 1 verse 19 says, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. I pray you will be willing and obedient.
Amen.
Because he said, in returning and rest, shall you be
saved.
So if we are not willing to return and obey him, can we be saved?
No.
In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. Does your strength come from anyone apart from God? So when you don't find a place of quietness, you cannot find a place of confidence, and you cannot find a place of strength. Mark 1:35, Jesus Christ woke up early in the morning, alone we go. Quietness. So study the Bible, study the Bible. You think they're forcing you to do what you don't want to do. It's for your good.
Yes, sir.
You must understand it. God, God wants to talk to you out of those pages of the Bible. What if Simon was not willing to obey? Hello? What if he was not willing to obey? That day, the business is finished, isn't it? So I was asking, I said, what if Simon decided not to do as he was told? What would have happened to him on that day? That's exactly what happens to us when, on one hand, we say we believe God, on the other hand, we don't. This is praying amiss. This is what happens when we do not obey God's word. There will be delays. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. James 1:6. Verse 7 says, but let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. Which man? Which man?
The man
that is doubting. Verse 8. For he is a double-minded man, unstable in some ways. Once God can see that you are unstable in one way, it has nullified all your potential. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So double-mindedness is the same as doubting God. To be double-minded is to pray amiss. You're asking, how do we pray amiss? We pray amiss. Number one, how do we pray amiss? With wrong motives. We pray amiss when it just to fulfill your own pleasure. Number two, how do you pray amiss?
Disobeying for justice when you are not doing what is just.
See, you want God to do justice for you. You are praying for justice while at the same time you are taking justice into your hand. Number three, how do we pray amiss?
Not obeying God's words,
disobedience to God. And then number four, how do we pray amiss?
Double-mindedness.
Double-mindedness is on one part you believe that God can do it, on the other part I rather do it myself. Double-mindedness is called split minds in psychiatry. See, the mind is split. Can be triple, can be four. So it's split in different parts. You must not do that. Because you cannot have a double mind and you said you are praying to God. To which God? The one there, the one there, the one there, the one there. Which one?
The one up there.
All right. So if it's the one up there, it's not up there and him here. If you are praying to him, then you do what is, you fear him and do what is right, and you will be accepted. Okay? So this is just to conclude for you that praying amiss comes in different ways, as we have narrated. He said, let this man not think he can receive anything from God. You cannot pray amiss and receive something from God. So Father, we thank you. Lord, we bless you. Let's pray. Thank God for what you have heard. Thank God for what you have been taught. Thank God for His word. His word is spirit and life. Perhaps you have been praying amiss. You have been praying and missing. You have been praying off target. You have been praying off course. Why don't you return to God? And returning and rest, shall you be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. Isaiah 30:15. But you will not. But tell Him, I want to. Tell Him, I will return to you, Lord. I will find rest in you, Lord, even in the day of trouble. I will find a place of strength. In the place of quietness shall be my confidence. Help me, O God, not to forget who you are in the day of trouble. Help me, O God, not to forget your presence with me, even in time of trouble. And commit that thing that is troubling you, commit it to God. Nevertheless, I tell you, shall God not avail for his own that cry out to him day and night? Prayer must be regular. Prayer must be persistent. Prayer must be one-minded. Prayer must be straight to God. Prayer must not be with doubting. Prayer must be with persuasion, persuasiveness in God, that God can do it. Jesus said, nevertheless, I tell you, that God will avenge for them speedily. Let God avenge for you. You cannot be praying for justice and taking justice into your own hand. Let's ask God to help us not to pray amiss anymore. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
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 Clap your hands together for the Lord. Amen.